early 1980s, a major dispute arose between the Argentine and United Kingdom governments in the South Atlantic Islands region, known to the British as the Falkland Islands. This resulted in a short war, which the British won. After 30 years, we are now able to establish that a secret non-human or ET connection exists, and the existence of a special, intelligent and aware so-called oil, which has been portrayed in the X-Files and Prometheus films. Something so overwhelming and terrifying that it is believed was the cause of the many murders and deaths of scientists and computer programmers at the Marconi Communications Company in Britain. David Griffin from Exopolitics UK gave an initial presentation of this at a July 2012 conference in Liverpool. The AMASH project now provides his presentation with extra information and analysis, leading to a possible connection with a similar etheric intelligent black oil which infests communications and communication systems.
Okay, this is Basis 17, and we are joined with the AMASH project, Exopolitics, UK, England, Scotland, someplace up north. And we were going to be joined by Richard D. Hall to give our current guest an absolute grilling, because tonight's subject is so important, we needed to really haul his ass over the coals. So, unfortunately, we're going to have to sit in. I'm going to have to adopt that role, and we're going to see what's really going on. And this is about Falklands and ET elements to the 1982 Falklands War.
And we're here with David Griffin from Exopolitics.
Thank you for having me to join the AMASH list, the growing list of AMASH interviewees. None of this is on the internet, and it's all pretty original.
Can I just say, this is the result of also 2 years' work, David, isn't it, as well?
Two years' work, and I'm indebted also to a contactee called Alex Newald, who's New Zealand, who I've basically been in communication with and has been most helpful with this. So basically, I've put together a couple of years' worth of research, and I hope that it's got somewhere, and it's still ongoing at the moment. So if you watch the film, the main proponents, the Illuminati guy, is actually British, and he's the one that actually breaks ranks with the Illuminati. If you go back and watch the film, they have this crisis meeting because this certain substance has been found, this virus, and it's the British guy in his British house that decides to go and find Mulder and basically give him this antivirus, this thing. But if you rewatch that clip or the whole movie, there's a lot more. Just that clip itself gives you a lot more, tells you a lot more about what's actually going on, and pans out into geopolitical events that I found were going on with this actual issue itself.
Now, the thing I'm very interested about this is that this black fluidic energy, that there is a black fluidic intelligent nanovirus.
They're mentioning that sort of thing, and it very much mirrors what is found out here, which we're going to come to. But yes, it's a black oil like substance, which puts a whole new meaning on this whole idea that we're hunting for oil, particularly. And you'll probably know more
oil
about this.
Itself.
Well, oil itself is this metaphor. It's very, and it's
and
really hit me.
The mechanism which we release oil is using smokeless fire, which is the definition of releasing the djinn into our reality.
Right. Well, when you've heard this, you can perhaps talk a bit
but
more about that.
But the point is that in the early days, I mean, there's a picture of Energy 106 behind you in the background there, or there was. The point about this is that this black fluidic substance has been seen, and it's been seen at Harwell.
Right. So he was a
patent attorney at Harwell.
Okay, and this was an oil, nothing that
he
from
saw
the end, it wasn't
black fluidic life forms crawling along the earth and going down into the cable ducting.
Everyone listening, that sounds completely sci-fi, but...
Not sci-fi.
Well, I'm just trying to...
Direct observation.
Yeah, and Harwell, I know the bit of history, a little bit about what Harwell deals with. Interestingly, because you mentioned he was in the patent office, I've got a quote here, which I'll read out later, about when...
His company had an office there.
Okay, yeah, but when this first stuff first turned up at Marconi, as we'll find out in a little while, then they did this South African intelligence guy did lots of checks, and they all talked about how at the time there was no patents, they couldn't find any fellow military companies that had anything like this. But this was the very mid-80s, so when the period that your friend witnessed that, I would be highly interested in what year that was, because that would then if that was later on, the late 80s, that would make a lot more sense.
About the 2000s.
Right, okay, could even be around then, because apparently the British, according to the South African Intelligence Agency, down in the Falklands, he claims that the British struck gold, and you know, this whole, again, metaphors, oil, gold, black gold, starts to get quite crazy. Again, we got that headline that I remember, and
so this is from the Sun.
This is from the Sun at the time, and so I just made the point that you know, underneath this war, it looked like something else was perhaps going on, and you know, the fact that, if you know, many people said this, why on earth did we send all these fleets down for these tiny little islands? Given what we said about oil,
it did seem extraordinary.
Yeah, oil's really hard to extract from down there, the oil rights and things like that. But we know lots of things have been going off in down in the Antarctica. There's the Nazis have been down there. We'll cover a bit of that in a minute.
Can I just read out that little bit, David, in case people have difficulty with that, just to understand it? Behind the media hype that boosted Thatcher's poll ratings lay a hidden agenda that has not been publicly linked to the war before, and the ET aspect of the scenario are both central, but sufficient evidence exists to make a strong case without it.
Yeah, so, and that's the point I wanted to sort of say, that, you know, because we get a lot of flack in this scene for contact, things that are just based on what ETs have said and things, and there's you know, I'm not denigrating that at all. We're, you know, big believer in all that stuff, but it's still making the point that if you can put this mosaic together and have other elements around it from politics or from whichever field, then it means that you're building a case, and it makes the whole ET issue far more important, and obviously also says how central, which I hope you'll find by the end of this sort of talk, how central the ET issue is to all these political events that we see the surface of. Well, just when I was at university in Bradford, I'd just been to see Pink Floyd The Wall on huge IMAX in Bradford, and we went to a curry house with one of my friends, and sitting having a curry, there was a guy opposite with his partner, and I think whatever we were talking about, I can't remember, a long time ago, he basically, we must have been discussing something, and he butted in and he said, if you want to know something about the Falklands, there was a lot more going on in the Falklands than you realise. And he pointed like this and he said, things going on. And of course, not having had a huge interest in this field at that point, we just left it. But that was one of those things that it stuck in my head. I was like,
and
what?
And you know, when he was doing that gesture, did you think that indicated some kind of aerial activity of a...
I am pretty sure that's what he meant, because he also looked a little bit like, I don't want to say much more, and also a little bit disconcerted about having said it. So again, as part of this building up evidence, because I didn't want to just come out and say, yes, I found this ET issue to the Falklands, then started advertising on military sites, both in Britain and Argentina. And one Argentinian researcher sent me, and Joanne can actually pronounce the name of this person, because I can't, because she's very good at Spanish. Yeah. So this very famous contactee that I must just say had his case validated by J. Allen Hynek, and spoke at Argentina's main UFO event, and also got flown with Argentinian security, interestingly enough, got flown to do a talk in, I presume it must have been Lachlan, I don't know where, but a big US-based one. So this is...
Ricardo Jesus Velezquez.
Perfect. Okay. Essentially, yeah, in the run-up, the one year before the Falklands War, so we're talking, you know, 81-ish, he was basically picked up by a UFO, had no prior experiences with UFOs or ETs, was picked up by UFO, ETs landed, they took him to a base in the Andes, a very high-tech base. He said the rock opened up, in they went, huge screens everywhere. He claimed there were numerous ETs watching world events, including one, if I remember, of New York, one of something else somewhere else, some other forest somewhere, anyway, obviously monitoring the planet, as we often hear in contactee accounts. What was most interesting, given the timing of when they picked him up, I mean, this is second contact, so we got here February 1982, so again, better remind people, the Falklands War started officially in April 1982 and ended in June 1982, so 3 months before, a few months before, you can read there, I've highlighted in yellow, they took him to the same underground base. They had a look at these big 3D viewing screens, which they showed him something on before. This time he thought it was something like the South Pole, could see the ice flows and could see battles taking place. Mm. He then came to a point where he realised that it was a war in the Falkland Islands, so he must have realised from somehow recognised some sort of landmark.
I think here when it says I was taught, I think it was I was shown.
Shown, yeah. This is my I had to translate this using Google yeah. online translation because it wasn't in English. So, yeah, then saw warplanes, battles, prisoners being taken, etc. But interestingly, what the ETs explained to him then was that Britain was going to win the Falklands War, Argentina was going to lose. But the point that really struck me, having done the bits of research that I've done, was they said this was far... It was a political topic, but it was far more to do with business than it was to do with war. He then told this story to an Argentinian UFO researcher, and the military intelligence found out about him. And up until the start of the Gulf War, so from January to April 82, he was then repeatedly imprisoned and tortured for having said this. That they obviously thought he was a spy, or they knew he'd met these ETs. There's also another guy who basically on the side of Argentina where they had a military base. This is at the start of the war, claimed a huge UFO came over and all these Argentinian troops went out, saw this huge great UFO, huge apparently lights, and in his report a army jeep got moved 3 miles from one and got plonked in another field, and this was a report that went through to the main Argentinian UFO society. So just basically point out very, very quickly that we've had a long history down there. You'll find from the literally from the 1900s onwards, Russia is listed as expedition, mineral expedition, research this expedition, and it fills pages. They were out there, and it accelerated. You'll get the same, of course, for the US, also going down there. So something is going on there beyond what I could assume was just for looking at penguins, taking pictures of polar bears, and looking at the odd bit of mineral. You know, What you then also notice, as you find with Admiral Byrd's mission in 1947, you find that in the post-war period, I know we had all the Nazi stuff that was going on, something accelerated. In the Cold War period, something accelerated to the point that now every major nation has a full-time base down there, and they're getting more towards the centre of the Antarctic. So something's going on around there that's a bit more beyond, and I think it links into this substance that we've just discussed with Miles, because there seems to be a certain area, Lake Vostok, that they're very interested in. The whole argument with oil falls down because apparently getting oil from down there is just so prohibitive, because the conditions for getting oil out of the seas are rough. Supplying a base, keeping staff down there. So this is the boring historical side of things. So are we going to get to it? I just have to give a bit of background because I can't just come in with this straight stuff. When you ask why at the end, you know, towards the end of the Second World War, when we were exhausted from all this other stuff, were we then so having these arguments over this piece of ice, you know, this huge piece of ice down there, that something was going on? And again, as I then mentioned, we've got the other slide here with, a lot of this could be put down to the Nazis. We've got, you know, this amazing quote from Carl Dönitz, who is in charge of the submarine fleet. Now we get onto the region, and this is where it starts getting interesting and important. So for geography, because a lot of people probably get a bit stuck with whereabouts we're talking about. So of course, Argentina, you can see with the big land strip there, and Chile, etc., is all down there. If on the inset of the image, you can see there the Falkland Islands at the top, and these little strip that bending around this sort of backwards C shape there. The very bottom one of those is an island called Southern Thule, but I think in German is pronounced Thule. You've got to ask yourself, because also that's called Southern Thule, and I got confused. I call it Salt Thule because that's the easiest way to pronounce it for me. But in the Arctic, the Americans have a base that's called Thule in the Arctic as well. So we have a big Thule base in the Arctic, and we have a Southern Thule, this final island at the bottom of the chain that creates all the interest. We get this thing that actually kicks off this whole debate, which is the base being built on the Thule Island that we'll see there.
Okay, the base is in Antarctica, Falklands War, and Little Blue Aliens.
This is part two of the MASH Bases Exopolitics UK story about ETs and the Falklands War. David, thanks very much. Let's continue.
Okay, well, now we get to the more juicy bits after getting a bit of a background to the whole situation. So, essentially, yeah, after giving that little potted history of the whole Falklands War, what we actually find out is, of course, Miles mentioned before about South Georgia being the sort of spark point for the war. But actually, if you look into the history, you look back into parliamentary questions, etc., you find out that in 1976, a base was built on Thule Island, which is the one that we showed on the map that was there before. The Argentinians strangely went and built this base on Thule Island. It was supposedly a scientific base. And on the picture there, you can see that. That doesn't give a good view. I've got some other footage of it later. But that was supposedly a weather monitoring station and other things. Strangely enough, had about between 10 and 18 staff, and there was an armed military contingent on there as well. So, of course, the British from 1976 started noticing this because we had a ship called HMS Endurance, which many people will have heard of. Interestingly, it was about to be scrapped, and the only thing we had down there, this wasn't a warship, this was an icebreaker. And this was sending helicopters over and keeping an eye on this base and what was going on around there. So what you've got to keep in mind as we go through these next few slides, this next bit of information, is what did the Thatcher government or the military or the upper echelons of the military or the Illuminati type military that we saw in the X-Files clip beforehand, because of course we know that this thing doesn't pervade throughout the whole of the government, certainly not down into parliamentary politics. What did the was it the chicken or the egg? Did the Argentinian war take place because of the reasons that we were given over land and territory, oil rights, all the other reasons we were given, or was something else going on? Because by the end of this, I think you'll see that this other issue was far larger. They essentially start monitoring what's happening on this Thule Island. And remember, these conditions, if you can see that base is built off the ground, the conditions here, it goes down to like minus 60 degrees Celsius, I think I read. The whole Antarctic is down to that.
Is it a large island, David?
Thule Island is a volcanic island, although I've got a large shot of it in a minute. It's a volcanic island, ice sort of plateaus, but no, it's not big at all. I don't know the actual size of it. If you go and have a look, you'll see that compared to the other islands, it's one of the larger ones, like sort of triangular shaped, but certainly it's pretty small. We could find out the actual size of it, but no, not big at all. But anyway, interesting things are actually happening on this island, as we'll find out. So behind the scenes, there was some diplomatic stuff went on between the Lord Carrington, who was the sort of foreign guy, and he encouraged the Foreign Office to send a submarine down there as well. Again, interesting why, before anything had broken out, they send down a nuclear submarine to keep an eye on the whole process. So that's the base on Thule Island down there that the Argentinians had built. What we then find out, and you'll have to bear with me for this, because I actually found this information out from a contactee regarding this blue extraterrestrial race. There's not a lot known about them, but as you will know, if you look into sort of Vedic Hindu literature, you'll find the references to apparently one humanoid race is one of these five strands of humans that were genetically put on the Earth. I think I'm right in saying this. This wasn't their gods. It was actually us. Humanoids, there were humanoids in a blue form, but you can't find constant references to these blue-skinned races. I find that interesting because you talk about blue ETs or this blue race and you don't come across it much. Someone stopped me at the end of the last conference and said that Dolores Cannon had done several cases where blue ETs were mentioned. So again, he backs for sort of America there. I don't know why, you know, you don't come across it much in the certain British literature. This guy...
Yeah, that's why I thought of
it. I've come across them with some of our people that we've spoken to, and they seem to be the little, quite small,
smallish
beings.
4.5 foot, he says, 4.5 foot, and greyish like in a way. We know greys, but certainly seem more hybrid like in a way. Anyway, this guy actually got taken to their planet. No time to go into that, but the guy I'm on about, Alec Newold, is an engineer. He's not, you know, he's not some sort of dippy, new agey contactee. The guy's an engineer. Had no interest in this area and went and got taken to...
he was actually taken for 10 days, I understand,
wasn't
he?
Yeah, 10 days, his car taken off the road in New Zealand and got taken to their planet, from a planet called Haven, don't know if that's the actual term, their term our term, taken to a planet called Haven, an amazing story, then got dropped back and many things started to happen to him then. So he briefly mentioned this in the book and about the Falklands, and so I started this dialogue with him and got a little bit more information about it. So essentially, to summarise, we find out that these Blues had a base underground. So while the Argents had one on top, these Blues had a base underground. They'd had one there since World War One era. And this is the crucial part that you have to remember. And I would be interested, Miles, given what you said about Harwell and what was found there, because the whole reason they had to do it, remember how far this island was, is the basically the closest you can get to Antarctica, so the, obviously the colder you get, to work on this nano oil substance, they had to do it in an absolutely freezing cold temperature. This stuff gets active when it starts to get warm. It stays dormant while it's under the earth, under the seabed apparently is where it began. So as long as it's under pressure and is cold, it stays sort of dormant. They're working on this apparently to de-engineer it, because it's been put there since the start of, I presume, when we were put on the planet or a previous race. The danger is that it can be it sends out signals, it can be communicated with, and it can be engaged.
Can I just ask, just for clarification, because we're just looking at this slide here for a minute, just to really come back to the oil substance. Mm-hmm. It just says that the ETs project required their lab to be in an Antarctic climate.
Yeah.
So we're saying then that the Argentinians had a relationship with the ETs for, we suspect, a long time?
Don't know how long. Apparently, very high-ranking Argentines were well aware of this in the military, were aware of this.
Because of the German involvement.
David, that the US is also aware of this mission, and given it's the UK's position with the territory, they must also be aware. So just to come back to that oil issue, how did anybody become aware that there was a substance, an oil-like substance, that was essentially like a piece of pathological aware...
It's like a sentient AI.
A sentient, thank you. That's better.
We need to, in the current climate of what we're going to shooting, this, the film Prometheus brings this stuff.
I played the clip from Prometheus at this, because if you go and
I
see
haven't seen that yet, so.
Wonderful film, and yet again, just like The X-Files, and what was the other one with that had Keanu Reeves in recently, also had a black mass that then went and took over and literally went through all the biology of life.
Interesting how this is seeping into then. I mean, it's like, everything in plain
sight
again, isn't it?
And of course the film The Blob.
The Blob, yeah, the thing. But James Cameron, I believe, is way high up, and I think the CIA, all these people talk to these sort of people, and that film Prometheus was, if you notice, was all about black goo that then morphed into creatures, and there's certain Alex Newell was taken to this planet. They basically gave him a complete potted history of the earth, and he didn't remember a lot of this. He came through back to him gradually, but one of the things that stuck in his head was the fact that a certain race had put this, that the Earth was formed with this as part of the geology. There were at certain places around the planet, and we found two or three of them, we think now, where this intelligent oil has been put, and it's almost like being ready to activate, and it's stayed dormant until now. And as we go on, you'll find some quite scary episodes of where we think it started to be activated. It's more or less like it's a gooey substance that has all these magical morphing qualities and stuff, but on the level of other things that it does, I don't quite know, and I don't want to leap into other areas because I don't know exactly how it actually functions. But we have got some evidence of it doing very strange psychological things, which we'll come to when we get to the Marconi people.
So we're basically looking at a black fluidic substance, like Miles says, that is oil-like in viscosity, let's say, has some kind of sentience to it
when it's awakened,
when it's triggered, and is in certain parts of the planet is speculated or known.
Yeah, quick mention. This is the book that. If you want to find out a bit more about the his experiences with these blue ETs, then that's the guy that I'm sort of indebted to for starting off this whole bit of research. That's Alec Newell's two books called Co-Evolution, and a fascinating read it is too. So that's his website at the top, where he does a blog very occasionally. Of the war, as I say, it's unknown to most people. The war started with this Southern Thule when the base was built in 1976, and it actually ended, strangely enough. You didn't hear any of this in the press, nothing at all. What then happened 2 weeks after the apparent surrender? So, you know, the surrender of the main Falklands War, all over, all the celebration, all that stuff about the flag going up over Port Stanley. Well, actually, what you'll find out is that we then gathered a series. I've got the list of ships here, and I can't name it off by heart, but I'll just play you a bit of video here. Operation Keyhole. Interestingly, the whole name, the code name, the military code name for the Falklands was Operation Corporate, which again comes back to the point that the ET said this war is more about, it's not so much about politics, it's about business. Isn't it interesting that the name for the Falklands was Operation Corporate? Well, isn't it also interesting that the very final, just to take over this tiny little so-called weather station, the operation given to that little escapade was called Operation Keyhole. You know, don't know where they get these names from. So they sent the frigate HMS Yarmouth, full-on fighting ship, ice patrol vessel HMS Endurance, a supply ship Oleander, and a rescue tug called the Salvageman, together with a squadron of Royal Marines. These were all sent to surround this tiny little island of Southern Thule. And you've got to ask yourself, why send, at the end of the war, such a big expedition for a tiny island when they know full well there are 10, 18 soldiers on board? So here is, it's 2 minutes long, here's the footage you can get it up to. Stories. It's got some, the music underneath is Argentinian music. This is a mixture of footage taken by people on the base, the scientists, and also some news footage. So that's the base. My guess is that this was taken by Royal Marines. So here are the Royal Marines. You know, fair few of them. And there they are on the base that you've seen pictures of. And the base was taken without a shot being fired, so
there's nothing there.
Well, yeah, nothing.
Or is it me? Am I missing something?
Well, exactly. That's the point. That was the treaty being signed for this thing. Look at the extent of explosives they use on this little base. Wait a minute. I mean,
I wonder if this is a Phil Schneider event.
Could well be.
And for those of you who wonder
Look,
oh my God.
I mean, that's some C5 explosives, and this is what's left of the base after. Do you think they were making a statement? I don't know. I'm still confused about why they had to do that, if that was a science base. You know, there was something... There's something going on there with that. So anyway, well, this serves as a distraction, but there's how they left the... interestingly, some Argentinians snuck back and put the flag back up. After the British flag went up, they went and put the Argentinian flag back up. So I think there was another revisit to then blow the rest of it up. I think some other task force went and did that again. I thought that was quite amusing in its way. Okay, so essentially now we find that this oil substance, apparently when they raided the base, the special services found a certain amount of technology that got taken, whatever that was, all the usual stuff that they probably find when advanced intelligences are operating on this planet. They also found samples of this black oil nanosubstance. Then, through a series of events, we find that it gets back to a certain company called Marconi. Now, when I gave this talk, someone said, how did you know that this got back there? Well, there are several reasons, which we'll find as we go along. One of which was that Alec Newells, the contactee who knew these Blue ET group, because of his story and because he got put in jail once for on a series of things that related to his car coming back with some very strange adaptions to it that got traced back to Jaguar in Britain.
He was on Jaguar.
Then got in touch while I was in jail over this, refusing to pass information on to them about his these ET contacts. He got jailed for that and other
Oh, that's right, isn't it? Because he refused to answer their questions about his ET events.
There were many things. They were saying, we want to know what's happened with this. There was something to do with another crash. They wanted to identify some aspects of it. He refused to do it. It wouldn't cooperate at all. And he was put into a jail in New Zealand for quite some time, actually. A guy gets in touch with him from South African Intelligence, who we know that the South African Intelligence are very much linked to the British. Also, far more involved on world affairs than I think many people realise. A very efficient, if you look at the history of South Africa, a very efficient intelligence organisation. And he basically says that, yeah, the British that struck gold down in the Falklands, that this stuff was taken.
This is the South African intelligence guy.
Yeah, told him, yeah, said that this thing was taken to Marconi. But you don't even need to know that, because then if you then trace what happens after, then a lot of things start to make sense. So
what sort of year are we in here?
So I was just making some points there, basically linking them. You know, Marconi at the time were way ahead. They're a British company under a General Electric. I got it wrong in a talk I gave. I thought General GEC were GE were an American company, but apparently GEC are a British company. The General Electric company were our umbrella company, so the whole thing is a British-owned company, along with Plessy, who you'll see next, based in Chelmsford in the UK. They've been around, obviously, they're around since the days of the wireless. Miles will know more about that than you know. Since the days of the wireless, they were given the patent and instructions about how to manufacture the first wireless sets, etc. Well, it's claimed, the only claim, there is some scientific research on this substance, and it's called augie, A-U-G-I-E, and it's similar to gold. It's got some gold structure, and apparently it can morph into anything within its chemical makeup. Now, I don't know what that is. I don't know what its chemical formula is. All I know is that Au is linked to gold, and apparently they've found out that that is the case. I don't know much more than that, but it is sentient, and it does seem to be able to morph into certain things and have a life of its own, which is where the danger. It also can interface with obviously computers, which is where we come to the next bit. Plessy was another company that you'll find involved in these. The next pattern I'm about to show you, Plessy, another high tech company. And the interesting part, you've got to remember the dates for this. The dates are really important, because when these Marconi deaths that I'm talking about came about, no one really realised why all of a sudden did these sort of things start happening.
We haven't actually mentioned that just to this point, David, just as you said that. So we're talking about how Marconi was the recipient for research, I assume, of this black sentient material, along with Plessy. And from that, then down, I don't know when the years are, you'll tell us, there were some many numbers of deaths of scientists there, and that's what you're just talking about.
Yeah. And if you look at the links, basically, if you imagine, my take that I was talking about with Grant Cameron before is that America's got a whole, since 1947, the national security state, America's got a whole infrastructure based on its readiness to accept alien artifacts and alien knowledge, and even ETs themselves. They've just got that built in. They've got the infrastructure, they've got the power, they've got the finance to do it. I think Britain in the early 80s wasn't ready for what was about to happen to them, and they tried to keep some of this for themselves. They found it in what they counted as their war, and they tried to deal with it to get a technological advantage, and it bounced back on them. And you'll see in a minute. What's interesting, I found, is that GC Marconi became its most powerful and turned into one of the major defence and satellite communication companies when they merged with Plessy. But this advantage came, and they merged in 1986. So that's just a guess of mine. But it started. Just realise if this magical nanofluid came back in 1982.
And Plessy and GEC were crucial in taking that over.
This guy who wrote, you're right there, this guy who wrote this book got constantly diverted off when he tried to ask the military about what was going on with Marconi and what we're about to discuss next.
And that book, sorry, is called Open Verdict by Tony Collins.
Tony Collins wrote this book, published in 1991. Basically, he was editor of Computer Weekly, and he kept getting certain deaths from people in Marconi turn up on his desk because he was editor of Computer Weekly. And he was amazed that no other newspaper was actually reacting to this.
I think Flying Saucer Review twigged on this.
Probably as well. But he was the one that went and did all this stuff. But anyway, the point you just made, he kept getting pushed to this thing called Operation Tamagin, and it's based on the name of a bird, but that was all to do with what you said, that the British were way ahead in what was then mobile communications. So there was all about having... It's about having a mobile phone inside a tank that was encrypted, so you carried your own mobile system with you that couldn't be encrypted. Mm. So something to do with communications he kept getting linked to there. So you're right with what you were saying about
and
DC.
Siemens, of course, have now taken over all communications for broadcasting.
Siemens have taken over a lot of the stuff that was found by Marconi. Yeah,
the modulation of light and the way that all signals are transmitted.
I don't know about that.
Light-biased systems.
Right.
Well, is that Siemens as well?
Yeah.
I knew Siemens had got the technology that Marconi had revolutionised. So I made the point about the merger. It was quite interesting. The two most powerful electronics companies in Britain at the time, certainly even worldwide, then merged and became this conglomerate. Okay, so we're on to the points here that then sort of follows on from all this. So you have this bizarre substance that comes from the booty of war. And there's loads of British papers covered this, and all these deaths started happening in the IT sector, defence sector, etc.
So if I can just read out some of those headlines from the Los Angeles Times, it says, their firm linked to Star Wars, British scientists' deaths, suicides or conspiracy. And computerweekly.com, mysterious deaths, freedom of information, Marconi and the Ministry of Defence. And the Chicago Tribune News says scientists' deaths mystify the British.
Yeah. And there was, I could have got loads more British cuttings for that, but they're very hard to, obviously this was the 80s, they were quite difficult to find on the internet, but this did obviously enter the British papers, and no one made the links really until a little bit later on. It took a bit of time because of course the MOD kept putting out, this is defence industry, everyone gets stressed, this is what happens. But someone worked out the amount of deaths compared to every other defence industry in other areas, and it was huge. But we'll get on to...
Just on that point, you can ask the MOD lots of questions, but if you ask the Department of Trade and Industry the same questions, you will not get any answers.
You'll get less than the detail.
You will certainly not get answers in a very blunt form.
Right.
That's where the business is done.
I could have tried the DTI for Sashi, some of this. That would have been quite interesting. The patterns here I think are absolutely phenomenal, and it's a shame about these slides. I mean, I'll give Miles another copy of these images, but I'll point these out now that you can see. So essentially, you know, you start counting these deaths. I mean, there's one there in 1982, so there's a bit of leeway, but essentially if you look at the patterns of these deaths that took place, these were all people working on Marconi. I mean, you can see there's people, Lieutenant Colonel Anthony McCoy, defence experts, at the Royal College of Military Science. A lot of these are hard to read. I could read them off here, but there's not really enough time to go through them. Obviously, down the side, you'll see their method of death, suicide, which is what they're always called. This is why the book's called Open Verdict, because believe me, every police force seemed to bow down and make everything a suicide, even though they were absolutely bizarre.
There's one there. I just have to look at that one. It's called Decapitation.
That was the one I was going to mention. Poor guy. That's
26-year-old.
A 26-year-old.
Ashad Shah.
Very young programmer. Well, if you want to think about how would a young 24-year-old programmer, quite optimistic in his life, was, I think he was about to get married at that point.
He cut off his own head. How do you do that?
Well, how do you do that? His method of death, apparently. His method of death, I can read it out in full from here. He essentially allegedly... tied one rope round his neck. He then also ties the other end of a rope to a tree, I think it was, or a lamppost. Obviously, he did a nice tight knot. Got into his car, wound down the window with this still attached, and then pressed his accelerator to the floor, picked up speed, and pulled his head off.
A nice way to go.
And just a very strange, you know, strange way of all these suicides, when there are many other ways to actually kill yourself with far less pain and far less trauma. Decapitation, suffocation, asphyxiation. I mean, when you go into some of these, they are bizarre. You know, a family man found by son and daughters who'd gone into his garden shed and had put electric wires over himself and electrocuted himself. Just numerous ones. Guy jumped off, another guy, one of these other young Asian programmers, jumped off the Bristol suspension bridge, and they, when they found the body, it had a puncture mark in his one of his buttocks. This goes on and on. But the point, anyway, you can go and look these up for yourself. The lists are on the internet. The point I want to make, given the issue we said about the Falklands, are the dates here. So we have March 82, April 83, March 1985,
November 85, August 86. Gosh, they're all like almost within 6 months of each other.
Notice
almost
how they build up for the 86s. So August 86, October 86, January 87. So yeah, so we're not finished yet. So we come on to the third page, and
January 98, March 1988.
Sorry,
88. Yeah, and March 88, August 88. August 88 and September 88. Good Lord.
Okay, so this is, that's 22. I mean, someone counted 25, I think, but these are the, you know, these are the main ones that.
So asphyxiation seems to be quite a popular one, and so does electrocution. Those are favourites.
Electrocution, asphyxiation. What were a few of those ones?
A death leap. I've seen one or two different.
Here's another one that comes to mind. An auto accident where, and then a totally married guy, totally happy, happened to bump, drive into a wall at 70 miles an hour, and silly old him, he'd got six canisters of gas in his boot, and of course they blew up. Don't know why a computer engineer, I forgot what his actual work was, would need six canisters of propane in his boot, but of course, I think he escaped from that. But then
they got him afterwards.
Yeah, he went again then. Anyway, now what's interesting about all these is the, as I say, the dates, because these then basically stop. So you've got this sort of life of what I think is a project that's going on.
It sounds like it, doesn't it?
Yeah, and the other thing that I noticed is that you have, at the start, I went and researched some of the early people to die, and they both brought in a expert from Essex University, one of the foremost early computer programmers, had basically learned how to create hospital records before anyone else, professor at Essex University. He was one of the first to be brought into the project. Also, this army guy from the science college, 49, he was brought in. And it made sense to me, if you're a project, you're a military guy, you're setting up a project, you bring in two senior people, especially a computer programmer, you say, right, we've got this stuff, you know, we need to what to do it. You then employ the junior programmers. You have to bring in people that know a lot about new stuff like computers. So we have then the deaths of these two, got the whole details of their death in this death dossier here, which is quite long. I've got the details of the two Asian guys' deaths, and they're both extremely happy guys, and they were experts in Fortran, a programming language. They also both seem to be dealing in the realm of computer simulations. Others were experts in satellite communications. There was a sort of remit that certain of them were part of, mostly to do with computers and simulations. This seems to be a big part of the project. But so part of my analysis, having done that and read Tony Collins's book, is that they essentially...
Can I just read one thing before you go on? The suffocation one, the penultimate one. It says, Richard Pugh, computer consultant for the Ministry of Defence, he was found dead, wrapped head to toe in rope that was tied four times around his neck. And the coroner listed his death as an accident to a sexual experiment gone awry.
Yeah. The scenario that I think came around is that when Marconi received these things, because like I said, they didn't have this infrastructure like the Americans had for dealing with these things. If you saw Dan Sherman talk at the last Exploits event, he was only part of quite a small ET, it was an ET communication thing that he had to do through a computer using his mind. But he went through the whole system of how they have these grey projects that are then surrounded by black projects,
yes,
to stop people getting
in. Yes, that's right. I remember reading about
absolutely
that.
Amazing the way that they said it came to the mid to late 70s and the UFO public has started to guess how they were operating and could get too far into these projects. So they devised, it wasn't before that, he claimed it was in the mid to late 70s, this onion thing. Sounds very obvious, but the complexity of which, of hiding these grey projects.
Like the Russian doll thing.
Yeah, Russian doll thing. Yeah. So you have your alien project surrounded by a black project, and then you have a normal project around that. Well, I don't think the British had this sort of stuff. I think they were good at it because we, you know, in the war we taught the Americans a lot and stuff. I think we didn't know what was happening, and we didn't know how to deal with this stuff when it turned up. And so what happened was you had to then pull people in from that weren't normally conditioned to the military way of doing things. Yeah, so you grab people from Essex University, you went and got programmers from abroad in India, and
well,
you
also
brought
at that
over.
Time we're not as far down, you know, as we are now in 2012 for programming and all the rest
nowhere
of that,
near.
Are we? It was an entirely different era. It's like a different age, wasn't it?
And if they got a hint, say if the SAS had raided this base and they'd seen that these samples of oil were perhaps rigged up to some sort of fibre optics, whatever the ETs had used, they must have got an idea somehow that this stuff could be interfaced with. They knew enough about it. I don't think they knew entirely what they had on their hands, but they knew enough about it that it could be interfaced with. So they bring in these computer programmers. I think as part of this, two problems happened. A, they had to read some... At that stage, they had to, as the military said, they had to read them into the project, but at a level that they wouldn't normally do. In other words, they had to sort of say, well, look, where's this has come from? Had to brief them and basically say that this stuff has come off planets. Now, to a very conservative young computer programmer, that could be quite unnerving, you know, to a degree. I think on top of that, what seems to have happened, as we'll see from a quote in a minute, is one of these scientists found out that this stuff could be switched on in a certain way, and also certain things seem to start happening, that they had these nanobots made up. When you look at them under a microscope, or when this stuff starts to morph and operate, then things start moving, and you know, things start getting a little bit scary.
So are we saying, David, then, that this oil, whatever, the sentient stuff, it is off planet? Or is it within the Earth? Is it sort of a natural functioning of the Earth's, you know, evolution that's just reached a certain stage and now it's being triggered into a new level of
development? It seems to either have been... this is all conjecture. I think it was put here by whoever made this planet and put us on it as a safety device for if we fucked up, and if we screwed up as a race and created all hell, then this stuff would rewrite the planet. If you watch the Prometheus film, that's essentially what was going to go on. This stuff would genetically rewire and rewrite the planet in a terraforming way. Let's finish off the suicide, and then we'll go through because that gets actually quite interesting. So while I was talking to Alec Newald, he mentioned the South African guy was working, the South African intelligence agency worked and educated with a guy called Victor Moore. Lo and behold, who do I find in here? The Book of the Dead Scientists, but Victor Moore. Working as a design engineer for Marconi Space Systems, found dead of an overdose. Now, his wife claims she thinks it was a suicide, but something about his work had made him very uneasy, and she saw a total change in him overnight.
Really?
So there's one that probably was a suicide, but it's again a guy that was happy in his work up till then, but was asked to then join a new project. All this jigsaw fits together. Here's the other quote. Mr. X is the guy, the South African intelligence agent. He's now dead. He was quite an elderly guy, but had worked on a lot of these projects. Also been to Antarctica. Do you want to read? I can't see from this angle. Do you want to read these quotes?
He's just saying the British struck gold in the early 1980s, and it says, my contact in South Africa even knew one of the Marconi guys, as he had studied in the UK with him years before, in brackets, Victor Moore. He was the one that noticed when the oil was switched on, they started to get interference with their weather satellites. How interesting.
That's
is
crucial.
That
bit's crucial.
Very so. And that's from Alex Newald, Personal Communication, 2011. This friend let slip one day about a new robotic fluid their computer and engineer guys were working with that could be programmed with radio frequencies. There you go, Miles, that's wild, isn't it? They thought they might be able to use it hydraulically, which would open up all kinds of new design fields. When he asked around, nobody knew who invented it or where it might have come from, nor even any talk of patents to buy from another company.
Yeah.
Coevolution. That's Alec Newald again, 2010.
Yeah.
That's really interesting, David. I mean, my God.
Yeah. So,
wow.
Again...
That's startling
well,
stuff,
isn't
it? Well,
it's not a hydraulic fluid. It's an intelligent blood.
I disagree. When Alec Newald... One of his hints to me was to say, go and look, you'll find that Marconi probably opened a new hydraulics division around about that time. And I disagreed with that, because As you say, I don't think this fluid is hydraulic in the way that we think it's hydraulic.
I think
you're dead right.
It's an intelligent nanofluid which takes over, reanimates things.
Yeah, whatever it is, we don't put it into gadgets to make them lubricate and do things and do what hydraulics do.
No.
I think he was thinking along different lines to that. So, I totally agree, and I thought that at the time he told me that. Open verdict. Is there anything else I wanted to? Yeah, I was going to make a point that Tony Collins came to the conclusion in his book that these deaths, obviously he looked into it in depth, these deaths were basically all to do with either stress, or mostly he put them down to Cold War spy killings, or they were just inconclusive. Again, it was the 80s again, he was researching this in the 80s, the Cold War, as we just discussed, was still raging at that point.
Mm.
Well, that's a brilliant point to end this section on, and we'll have a smoke break.
David, it's getting more and more interesting. I can't wait for part three.
You wait.
Okay, thanks, folks. We'll see you in part three of the AMASH, the Bases and the Exopolitics UK Exposé on ET on the Falklands. See you then.